Good evening and welcome to All Saints Church on this joyful occasion. A couple of brief announcements regarding COVID. Please can you ensure that if you're able to, that you remain masked during the service. And when it comes to coming up for communion, can you please wait for indication from me that you can come up so we can maintain appropriate distances. Thank you very much.
Really good to be gathered together as one body, both physically and virtually, as we come together in God's presence and continue to celebrate that though we have to adapt ourselves in various uncomfortable ways to the times in which we live, nevertheless God is just as much present and with us as in any other time as that we could be in. So we do come together to celebrate, to give thanks, to rejoice with Matt, or Matthew, as he will be for this occasion, and Cramo, as they make their promises and declarations and are confirmed into the full communion of the Church, and also pray for ourselves in our own discipleship, that we too may be renewed by the gift of God's Holy Spirit. Let us pray. O God, the judge of all, who gave your servant John of the Cross a warmth of nature, a strength of purpose and a mystical faith that sustained him even in the darkness, shed your light on all who love you, and grant the union of body and soul in your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Seated for the first gift.
The reading from 1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 to 10. A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I come to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love Him, these things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Today is the day when, in the Church's calendar, as you will have heard from the collect, we celebrate St. John of the Cross. Born in 1542, John was a Spanish mystic and a poet. He was a reformer of the monastic life, and he came to experience the price of being a reformer, including opposition, misunderstanding, persecution, and even imprisonment by his fellow monks who didn't want him to reform their order. But he's more widely remembered as a poet. He was canonized in 1726. All of which doesn't answer the much more important question, why are we paying attention to him here and now? Well, John is important to me because he tells me something fundamental about God and about prayer and about living the Christian life. That seems to be good things to reflect on at a confirmation. And I want to use as a lens for understanding his understanding of faith one of his poems, translated rather beautifully by Seamus Heaney, which is called in Spanish Fonte, which could mean fountain or spring or source or any of those really. And I'm going to read it. It's not long. But not much. How well I know that fountain, filling, running, although it is the night. That eternal fountain hidden away, I know its haven and its secrecy, although it is the night. But not its source, because it doesn't have one, which is all sources, source and origin, although it is the night. No other thing can be so beautiful. Here the earth and heaven drink their fill, although it is the night. So pellucid it can never be muddied, and I know all light radiates from it, although it is the night. I know no sounding line can find its bottom, nobody ford or plumb its deepest fathom, although it is the night. And its current so in flood it overspills to water, hell and heaven and all peoples, although it is the night. And the current that is generated there, as far as it wills to, it can flow that far, although it is the night. And from these two a third current proceeds, which neither of these two I know proceeds, although it is the night. This eternal fountain hides and splashes within this living bread that is life to us, although it is the night. Hear it calling out to every creature, and they drink these waters, although it is dark here, because it is the night. I am repining for this living fountain. Within this bread of life, I see it plain, although it is the night. A strange poem, you may probably be thinking, but I hope you've heard its beauty too, and a calling in that refrain, although it is the night. John is trying to invite us, as he does in much of his writings, into a way of encountering God which is not through the things we know and understand, but by putting aside our own knowledge and understanding and reaching out to the God who is beyond all that we can get our minds around, all that we can grasp, all that we can get a handle on, all that we can understand. That is what the night stands for in John. He's not talking about literally stumbling around in the darkness. He's talking about pushing ourselves out in love into that meeting with God which is beyond what is in our control. And the poem explores what it is that that journey of faith discovers when it reaches out in the night, reaches out in faith. Let me take you through some of the things which strike me as I work my way through that poem. Firstly, that what is discovered is not strange. How well I know that fountain, he begins. Even though I've turned away from everything I thought I knew in order to come to God, I find when I meet God that I already knew God, that the presence of God was already at work within me, creating the conditions for my loving relationship with him. Part of the picture there, I think, is that gift of living water given to us at our baptism, always there, God at work, bubbling up within us. And for those coming to confirmation, that baptism being brought to fruition this evening. The life of God that flows into the hearts of the believer is both beautiful and pure. Nothing can dirty or pollute it. John reminds us that Christian faith is about our heart and our feelings, at least as much about as it is about our thoughts and our doctrines. In God we see again and return to the original beauty of a creation without sin. It is that heavenly, beautiful vision of God's kingdom that draws us on, even though we cannot see it fully, because we are in the darkness of a world which does not fully reflect God. And the fountain of God's love is endlessly deep, endlessly overflowing towards God's creation. There is no rationing of the divine grace except insofar as we turn away from it ourselves. It reaches out into the most hidden and desolate places. It reaches out to everybody. This at a time when Spain was in a very anxious state. The last Muslim kingdoms in the south of Spain had only just been conquered by the Christian monarchs. The Jewish population was very large. The Christian identity of the country was uncertain. And John himself came from a family which had converted from Judaism to Christianity. And even in the night of faith, God can see the nature of God as Trinity, three currents of Godhead within the one flow of God's nature. As we meet with God, we are not sinking into some impersonal divine force, but meeting a God who is personal, who is in community within God's self and Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we are invited into the perpetual relationship of the outpouring of creative love, which is at the heart of God. That is at the root of our Christian calling. All the other things we're called to do and to be are part of our journey on the way to that final calling of being one with God, in Christ. And prayer, perhaps, is the very closest place we come to the root of to that calling in our lives. Because prayer is relationship, first and foremost. Prayer is not ever primarily about asking for things. It's about being in a relationship with the God who loves us. And it's in that relationship of love that we bring to God our joys and our concerns and those of our world. John reminds us that we are invited to bathe in the river of prayer, which is the life of God within us. And finally, John reminds us that this mystical, unseen, mysterious presence of God is also, in fact, made visible and tangible, offered to us when we celebrate the Eucharist together, partake in the bread and wine of Christ's body and blood. Jesus' words of invitation, "This is my body, this is my blood," invite us into that gift of receiving and then sharing the very life of God which we are given and which we are then called to share with others. That gift which comes first in baptism and is renewed again and again in our lives as we turn to God and is completed in this rite of confirmation. For John, the night is a symbol of our dependence on God and the place in which we are most able to receive from God. It is when we acknowledge our own inability to save ourselves and our absolute need for God's saving, loving grace. And as we open the door to God to do that hidden work, he is at work in us, enabling us to be God's people. So let us pray tonight that God may be at work within us, sometimes hidden and when we don't even know it's happening, but nevertheless continually doing his work, and especially in Matthew and Cromwell as they come to make their promises tonight. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So now, Provode, Matthew, you please stand, and I ask you, have you been baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit?
Amen.
Are you ready with your own mouth and from your own heart to affirm your faith in Jesus Christ?
Amen.
Then I address the whole congregation, and including those of you who are out there. Faith is the gift of God to his people. In baptism, the Lord is adding to our number those whom he calls. People of God, will you welcome these candidates and uphold them in their life in Christ?
With the help of God, we will.
In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvellous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore, I ask, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God? Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil?
Yes.
Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbour? Do you turn to Christ as Saviour?
Yes.
Do you submit to Christ as Lord?
Yes.
Do you come to Christ, the way, the truth and the life?
Yes.
May God, who has given you the desire to follow Christ, give you also strength to continue in the way. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to profess together with these candidates the faith of the Church. Will you please stand as you are able to? Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us and rose again?
We believe and trust in him.
Believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known to the world.
We believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith.
We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who has made heaven and earth. Blessed be the name of the Lord,
now and forever. Amen.
Almighty and ever-living God, you have given these your servants new birth in baptism by water and the Spirit, and have forgiven them all their sins. Let your Holy Spirit rest upon them, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and inward strength, the Spirit of knowledge and true godliness, and let their delight be in the fear of the Lord.
Amen.
Pray together. Defend, O Lord, these your servants with your heavenly grace, that they may continue yours forever, and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until they come to your everlasting kingdom.
Those who are baptized are called to worship and serve God. Will you continue in the Apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers? Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
With the help of God.
Will you proclaim, by word and example, the good news of God in Jesus Christ? Will you seek and serve Christ in all people, loving your neighbour as yourself? Will you acknowledge Christ's authority over human society by prayer for the world and its leaders, by defending the weak, and by seeking peace and justice? Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you may be rooted and grounded in love, and bring forth the fruit of the Spirit. Amen.
So, Matthew and Pramod, if you could just turn and face the congregation. And though we're not allowed to sing, we're not allowed to cheer, we are allowed to applaud. So I think let's give them a round of applause. Face me. God has made us one in Christ. He has set his seal upon us, and as a pledge of what is to come, has given the Spirit to dwell in our hearts. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a socially distant sign of Christ's peace.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread and wine to offer, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual food and drink.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And now we give you thanks because by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a holy people in Jesus Christ our Lord. You raise us to new life in him and renew in us the image of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, and as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes, and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. With saints and martyrs through the ages, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever eats this bread will live forever."
Lord, our hearts hunger for you. Give us this bread always.
Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word.
body of Christ. Let us pray. God of truth, whose wisdom set her table and invited us to eat the bread and drink the wine of the kingdom, help us to lay aside all foolishness and to live and walk in the way of insight, that we may come with John of the Cross to the eternal feast of heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ Jesus, establish, strengthen, and settle you in the faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you now and always.
Amen. The Mass is ended. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.